Graphic Audio. A movie in your mind.
Graphic Audio presents Gun This Man Down by Lewis B. Patten. Matt Hurst stepped down off the train onto the wooden platform and eyed the town with eyes as bleak as the leaden sky. Snow drove along the ground before the biting January wind, forming tiny dunes as variable as a woman's moods. He stood for a long moment while his mind digested the unpleasantness of his memories. Then he picked up his carpet bag with his left hand, tossed his sacked saddle over his right shoulder, and strode down the slight rise of ground between the railroad station and town. A man's eyes, resting on his hometown after 5 years, ought to show something besides this cold unfriendliness. Else why would a man come home? There were a lot of reasons, he reflected. Among them, a deep need to understand the things that had happened, and a possibility of exacting vengeance. A few scattered horses lined the town's hitch rails, rumps to the wind, tails whipping between their legs. Smoke rose briefly from 50 chimneys before the wind snatched it away.
Damn.
The hotel, a yellow-framed structure with a balcony across the front at the second-story level, seemed to recoil from each new blast of wind, wind that came howling off the rolling sagebrush country to the north of town. Matt shouldered open the door, came into the lobby in a swirling cloud of snow, and dropped his bag and saddle beside the door. Nothing changes, he thought as he looked around at the game heads hung from the smoky walls, at the worn red lobby carpet, littered as always with cigar ashes and cigarette butts. Nothing changed, not even the sour-faced, bespectacled room clerk, Rudy Littlefield. Matt stepped across the lobby to the desk and flipped open the register. He signed Matt Hurst and looked up at Rudy, a mocking, challenging smile on his lips. He wasn't a tall man, nor was he overly broad, unprepossessing because his heavy sheepskin covered and concealed the long, smooth muscles of his shoulders, the deep power of his chest. Unprepossessing until you let your glance dwell on his cold gray eyes, on his mouth so thin and hard and bitter.
Matt Hurst! I thought you looked familiar. You've growed since I seen you last.
His eyes took on a gleeful excitement.
Give me a room and a key to it, then you can run out and tell the town I'm back.
Rudy eyed the low-slung Colt revolver that peeped from beneath Matt's hip-length sheepskin.
What you gonna do, Matt?
Do? What should I do?
Well, you come back to do something about Dan and Will and Frankie, didn't you?
A room and a key, Rudy.
Let them worry. Let them stew and wonder why he was back. Let them wonder because he was wondering himself. He hated the town and the people in it. He hated the slot they'd shoved him in ever since he was old enough to remember things. Del Tillman had always pegged Matt and his brothers.
You don't tame a wolf whelp by treating him good. He is what he is, and sooner or later, he'll turn on you.
That was what Matt Hurst was. A wolf whelp. A wolf pup that had run away to keep from being smeared with the same brush that tarred his father and his brothers. He knew now that he should have stuck. If he had, maybe things would be different. Maybe Dan and Will and Frankie would still be alive. Or maybe he should have stayed away. What could possibly be accomplished by returning? One man can't obtain vengeance against an entire community. And even if he could, would not the very act of obtaining it hurt him more than it hurt the ones against whom he acted? So immersed was he in his thoughts that he didn't notice the girl in the corridor until he was face to face with her.
Excuse me.
She stepped to one side to pass, and Matt, stepping aside himself, unwittingly moved the same way and found himself still facing her.
Pardon me, ma'am.
Quickly, he stepped back, and the girl did the same.
You stand still. I'll move aside.
Matt flushed, feeling like a fool.
All right.
The girl kept her glance on him with a close interest that further flustered him, and he began to notice her for the first time. Her hair was like honey in color, having a light yellow sheen on top, deeper, darker highlights beneath. Her skin was smooth and white, her lips full and soft. Her dress seemed unnecessarily tight at waist and bodice, plainly outlining her rather startling figure.
You're new in town, aren't you?
He nodded.
I'm Lily Kibben.
Matt Hurst.
Lily's eyes widened and her smile faded.
I see.
She stepped quickly past. He turned and watched her back as she descended the stairs, smiling wryly at her reaction to his name. The Wolf Whelp is home. That was what all the town would be saying. The Wolf Whelp is home and there's gonna be trouble. All right, damn it. Trouble hadn't been all that was on his mind when he started back. But if they wanted trouble, then let them have it. He found his room. Once inside, he strode to the window and looked down into the gloomy street. He saw Rudy Littlefield come out of the Bull's Head Saloon across the street and hurry back toward the hotel. He saw Alfred Polk and Del Tillman come through the heavy winter doors and follow Rudy. Matt moved close to the glass and stared insolently down at them. Rudy glanced up as he approached the hotel, saw Matt, and dropped his glance hastily. Tillman followed the direction of Rudy's glance with his own and scowled when he saw Matt in the window. Matt grinned. He shucked out of the sheepskin and eased the .45 out of its holster and checked the loads. When he replaced it, he seated it lightly. Maybe they figured on exterminating the Hurst clan once and for all, and he didn't intend to be caught unawares. He waited in the small room's center, not afraid, but feeling the same tight emptiness in his stomach that fear could engender. He was lonely, really, and angry at himself for being so. And he resented the fact that his homecoming stirred no welcome in a single one of the town's inhabitants. Why? He had never done anything to deserve this. But he was Dan Hurst's son, and because he was, they hated and distrusted him. He heard Tillman's heavy, arrogant tread on the stairs, heard Dell's tread alone, but he knew the sheriff was with Dell.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.